watching video three people and doing the like a web development project and using the program. Can you share us about what it's like, the reality of contributing to open source, how we use the program and open source project to like fulfill our desire. Okay. Okay, let's see our speaker and let you introduce yourself.
Hi, my name is Ulrich, and like I mentioned before, I'm in Switzerland. Today I'll be talking about the realities of contributing to open source. So the good, the bad, and the ugly. So we're first going to be looking at first what is open source. How can you go about contributing and then looking at the realities of the positives and the negatives of contributing. So open source software is where the source code is freely available and may be redistributed and modified. And this allows people four different types of freedoms when they use open source software. First being that they're able to use it wherever they want. So they can use it for a blog, for example with WordPress, they can use it as an e-commerce site, or they can use it for something completely different. And so this is the freedom that, one of the freedoms that open source software provides. Another freedom is to redistribute that software. So for example, if someone comes up to you and says, hey, have you got the source code for WordPress? You can easily give it to them on a USB stick and send them by email without having to worry about legal repercussions, like if you did so with music or a film file or something. Another freedom is to modify it. So you can modify the code as you like. So it's not like Windows where you can't see the source code and you can't make the changes. And this gives you an extra freedom to do as you wish. Fourth freedom is to distribute those modifications. So you've made some improvement to this open source software, and then you can share it with your friends, and there's no trouble to that. So you may wonder what makes WordPress or open source software so special. The first thing is that it's open. Like I mentioned before, with Windows, only Microsoft employees can work on it. But with open source software, anyone can do so. Another thing is that there's a community around it. So that means that anyone can contribute, and you create a lot of people coming together and improving the software. And then continuance. You may wonder what this is. It's when someone else can continue the project that you started. And we've seen this also in the past with WordPress. So before it was V2, and then the lead developer there stopped maintaining V2, and then Matt Wallenberg and Mike Little, or with different types of themes, and people have the freedom to do so when they were not in a closed source environment. And last, but not least, is security. And by having the code open source, anyone can look through that code and find security issues and report them back. So WordPress is regularly being reviewed by multiple companies who want to use WordPress and make sure that it's secure enough for them, where they can't do the same with closed source software like perhaps Windows from Microsoft. So you may wonder, WordPress or open source software is free. But how is the development funded? With how do they get the money to develop software like this? Microsoft gets licensing fees, and they're able to cover their cost of development through that. So for example, you've got Firefox, which is open source. they're able to cover their development costs from search engines like Google, who let them be the default search engine on their browser, and they get paid for that, and from donations. So this is React. You might know it as the tool that is being used in Gutenberg. And this was developed by Facebook, as they needed something better to run on their website. And so they are using it as an internal tool, and have decided to open source it and give it to the community that they can get more feedback on the tooling. And then you've got WordPress. So these have multiple sponsors. One of the biggest is Automattic, because they need it for their own website, WordPress.com. But then you've got loads of agencies and freelancers who are contributing back to the project too, because they want to see improvements in WordPress and see improvements for their clients. And then another one is Ghost. Ghost you might know as a Node.js CMS. And there they have their own hosted platform. And so that's where they get their money and able to fund the development. So there's multiple ways of funding open source software, and it helps to have an idea of how that works. And when you're contributing back, you can understand the whole process. So we're going to have raise your hand. So who has contributed to open source before? Okay, about half the room. Okay. Now who wants to contribute to open source? Not everyone. You might be in the wrong room then. And then the next question would be, who wants to learn where to start, how to start? So the premise is that everyone can contribute, regardless of what you like to do. So you have community, like today. We have WordCamp organizers who organize events. They're doing it all as volunteers. Then you have meetup organizers who organize events locally and regularly over the year. And then speakers like myself come here to volunteer and help out with the community and share our knowledge with other people. And then another is documentation support. So you might have people who want to know more or have problems with their WordPress installation. And there's a support forum where other people can help them who know a bit more about it and can help them out. Or documentation and understanding how WordPress works and if they get stuck so they can read up and improve themselves. And everyone can help with those type of projects. And you only need to know a bit more than the other person to be able to help them out. Then we've got polyglots. This team does translation. And so if you speak more than two or more languages, then you can help out with this team. You only need to be able to read and understand English, and then you can translate it into perhaps Thai. And that makes it easier for other people who don't speak English well, that they have their software that they're using in their native language. Yes. And then we've got the theme review team. So this is normally one that people don't know what they do. So you have themes on WordPress.org, and when they're uploaded, the code is reviewed for security and compatibility issues. And so this team here makes sure that the themes on WordPress.org are secure, and so that the people who are downloading them, the users, don't have issues. So if you're a developer, you most likely want to help out them with Core or WPCLI, which is the command line for WordPress. And these teams accept code patches or even just issues. If you find an issue in WordPress that you think needs to be fixed, you can open an issue in the track, and then someone will have a look at it. If you're more of a designer, then these two teams are more for you. So you've got the design team that helps out with designing WordPress and the related teams, and also doing testing, user testing, so that when WordPress develops a new feature, like they have done with Gutenberg, there was like at WordCamp US, there was a team getting the attendees to come and test out Gutenberg. feedback so they can bring that back into the development process and improve Gutenberg for the user so that it's not always just developers working on the feature, but you get real users' feedback. I think one of the most important teams that I find is accessibility. And accessibility is very, very important because there's a lot of people who have used a keyboard or some other device to access websites. And they are not able to use a mouse because of some type of disability. But it's not just people with permanent disabilities, but also it's temporary. So you might have broken your arm, or you've fallen, or you have something in your hand while you're using the computer, and you can only use it one-handed. And so these things make it a lot easier to use the website. And this team makes sure that the features that come into WordPress are accessible for everyone. And then two of the more smaller teams. One is training. They organize training exercises for bringing people into WordPress, how they can use it. And then you've got the marketing team, which tries to spread the word of WordPress and creates documentation and flyers that can be shared in the community to encourage users or other companies to adopt WordPress. So you might see there's a camera in the back, and this talk is being filmed. And this talk, if the quality is good enough, will go on WordPress.tv. And for that, they need people to edit the videos before they go online. And so that's a team. If you know how to use a video editing software, then you can help out in that team to make sure these videos go quickly onto WordPress.tv. One of the more smaller and hidden teams is Meta. And Meta looks after WordPress.org, the website. And so, but also the WordCamp website comes underneath there. And so they're always happy to have help to improve the WordCamp website to make life easier for organizers of WordCamps. And the final two smaller groups are mobile and hosting. Mobile is in charge of the Android and iOS apps that you use for WordPress, and hosting is collaborating with the hosting companies to improve hosting for WordPress. So now looking into contributing. I found this little cartoon online. You can see me in the corner talking about why you should contribute to WordPress and open source. And then someone in one of you in the attendees thinking, oh yeah, I should. And then thinking about how they can open a pull request on GitHub, make a change. So they come up with a bug request, but the feedback they get that someone else has already submitted a fix a few days ago, so their bug fix is not needed. Or they come up with a new feature, but then they have so many issues with the coding styles that they have to fix, and they get frustrated. Or they come with documentation. They want to improve the documentation or something, but then the feedback that they get is that this feature needs to be documented by someone else. Or they have a typo, and they think, but they make the correction in the wrong code. So all of us face these challenges when contributing to open source, and it's not always easy. But it's important that you realize that you have these challenges, and you will face challenges when you contribute to open source, and taking them within your stride and working around them. And then trying to give feedback so that the community can improve and reduce those hurdles for you or for the next people who are contributing. And there are people in the community who are willing to help you over these hurdles, and you just need to join the community and contact them. And there's always, you can always find someone who's willing to help you. So this was my first contributor day. And this was in Leiden in the Netherlands, in WordCamp Europe. And I think I'm somewhere right in the corner working on documentation. And it was always difficult because I didn't have any experience in PHP at that time. So I was like, how can I help? but I had a real passion for internationalization. And so I realized I could improve the documentation for internationalization for plugins and themes. And so everyone can find something that they're good at and they can contribute back to WordPress or open source software. And contributor days are great for starting. They had one yesterday here at work in Bangkok. And next year, hopefully, we'll organize another one where you can join in and learn how to contribute back to WordPress. But one of the feelings that I've always had is frustration when contributing. There's multiple reasons to get frustrated. Things don't go the way you want them to. Your feedback is not taken into consideration. But you have to choose your battles. You have to decide how important is it for me and not let the frustration that you face ruin your day. And sometimes it can help just to take a step back and come again from a different perspective or talk to someone in person or on Skype and discuss the frustrations that you're having, and sometimes you can have solutions come out of that. But these frustrations can also, like I mentioned, with communication. But communication can be difficult also. I don't know how many of you have English as their first language, and so it becomes a lot more difficult to communicate with other people because you don't always know the right word or the right phrase to use. But it's important to, when you communicate, to realize that the other person is not being necessarily mean, they're just having difficulty communicating, or they are not using enough emojis to express their emotions in the text communication. And so that's why it's always important to use some type of emoji to show your emotion, to show that you're not angry or irritated or frustrated, and to talk with them and clarify when you're unsure of what the other person meant. And then meeting people at work camps or at meetups can also help diffuse the situation. So if you had a problem with someone, you can go up to them and say, hey, can we talk about it? And then you can clear the air that way. So the next point is motivation. What motivates you to contribute? I was talking to someone yesterday, and he mentioned that he was in a discussion that someone said, how do I get a job at X company? And he said, oh, maybe it'll help you organized a work camp. But you can only do it with good intentions. You can't organize or join the community and just try to get a new job or to get famous. You should be doing it because you want to. It can be either to scratch an itch, to have a problem with WordPress and you want to fix it, or you want to learn more. I mean, that's one of my motivations being working in the theme review team, was that I learned more about best practices in coding. But your motivation might change. Initially, you might be doing it to make friends when you organize a meetup group. But this time, you've got enough friends, and you don't need any more, and it's draining meeting all these people. So you might decide to change and do something else. Or you might want to help mentor other meetup organizers starting their first meetup. And it's also very important to take enough breaks. So you're not expected to work or contribute back to open source all the time. It is okay to take breaks in the year and let other people help you out and fill in the gap when you're unable to fulfill or do your duties or help out. But with motivation, it also helps with recognition. We have had WordCamp organizers, volunteers helping out today, make sure to thank them today for their help and helping out today. And also, if you meet other people who have contributed to WordPress in different ways, make sure to thank them and to tell them that their work is appreciated. So talking about profit, how can you profit from contributing to open source? So there's no direct financial profit that you can make. there's no earning money when you're doing your contributions, but there's multiple other ways that you can profit. I helped organize one of the first work camps in Switzerland, and other people in the organizing team were running this agency called Required. And a few years later then, they offered me a job because I was able to build up a contact with them. And so there's all these different ways that from contributing, you build up your contacts, you build up new friends that you can rely on later on if you are needing help. So what we looked at today were the freedoms of open source, that the four different freedoms that you have and how that helped you and motivate the community to help each other, because you're not just profiting one person, but you're profiting the whole community with their contributions. Everyone can contribute, regardless of your ability, if you're a top programmer or you just started out. There are different skills that you can bring and experiences that you've had that can be used within the community. And you don't need to let the frustrations that you have get you down. There are ways of dealing with it and working around it, and that should not dominate your whole experience of contributing. And it's important to communicate positively and not negatively. Sarcasm is not taken well in text communication unless you know the person well. And so it's important to communicate in a positive attitude and in constructive attitude. And you might need to take time to find your motivation. You might not find it straight away, but you need to find what motivates you and define what motivates you to contribute. It's not enough because my boss said so, or because of peer pressure. It should be a reason that you have, I want to help out, I enjoy helping out, I am going to profit from this in a certain way, and define your motivation. And that leads to profiting from contributing. So there are multiple ways. And it might not work for everyone. I mean, some people contribute a long time, and they haven't found a new job. Some people contribute for a short period of time and they get a new job. So it's different for everyone, but you can profit for sure in some way or another. So my name's Ulrich, and you should support each other to contribute. Organizing a meetup does not take, I don't feel the amount of time it takes me to organize it. So it's one day a month where I, you know, have to travel an hour or whatever, go to meet up group, be there early, be the last person to leave, and things like that. But because you're interacting with people, it doesn't feel that much. But then other times, you know, you might want to spend time with your family in the evening. So you don't want to be the whole night working on some type of problem. Another way actually to contribute is also try to do it in work time. So one thing I have done also that I've been working on a problem for a client and realized there's a bug in WordPress. So in that time, I end up opening a track ticket and maybe even adding a patch to it and doing that within the work time and billing the client for that. Because in the end, that helps the client. It's they have this problem also, and instead of doing it separate.
This one is a thank you for the nice speech and the presentation. We